everyone. I'm Mary Pearl. I'm the interim dean here at Macaulay, and you are all so welcome. Thank you for being here. Besides our Macaulay students, alums, and parents who are all in the audience, I know I see some people from the Women's Forum, and then members of the theatrical community. We're just so honored to have people from the Musicians Union, from Okada, to so many places. I don't want to enumerate them for fear of missing someone who's here. And the reason is that this conversation could be not more timely. From actors who work in the theater, to the playwrights whose works are produced, to those who run the theater companies, to those who perform production work behind the scenes, do they reflect the broad diversity of New York's people? Are our city's cultural institutions great and small, accessible to the wide variety of people that constitute New York? These questions have really come to our attention with renewed force and energy this year. While the success of Hamilton has inspired us to think about non-traditional casting, sadly, there remains the continued casting of white actors in movie roles originally written as Asian characters. Hashtag My Yellow Face Story. There was an article about this in the Times. And in January, New York City's Department of Cultural Affairs released a report that New York's cultural sector does not match the demographic diversity of our city's population. And this isn't isolated. I can think of the IT sector, for example, as another area that requires the examination. But tonight we're going to hear about increasing diversity on stage and also behind the scenes, and what must be done to keep this issue front and center. We're so honored tonight to have brought four of the most influential people working in the arts in New York today to discuss these issues. Our moderator, David Henry Hwang, the Tony Award-winning playwright of M. Butterfly and Chinglish, among other works, we'll introduce our panel to you, but I just want to welcome them by name now. We're so excited to have them here. I feel like Macaulay's maybe punching above its weight here. We have Katy Clark, the president of the Brooklyn Academy of Music, or BAM. We have Oskar, the artistic director of the Public Theater, and Niegel, the artistic director of the Flea Theater. If I didn't take this moment to put in an ad for where you are tonight. This evening is the third in a series of talks celebrating the 15th anniversary of Macaulay Honors College. Now, many of you know that Macaulay selects New York's most promising students and provides them with a full tuition scholarship, global experiences, and personalized advising to ensure that they realize their leadership potential. To give you an idea, our student body has about 2,200 students. This is out of over a quarter of a million undergraduates in the CUNY system. So we really have the, it's not just the cream, it's I don't know what you'd call the little skin on top of the cream. Since our first class, there are nearly 3,000 students who have graduated unburdened by college debt and transformed by their experiences. And one thing I'm very proud of is that the first of four required seminars for Macaulay students, when they first arrive on campus, they are required to take a course on the arts in New York City. Our teachers take students to museums, to dance performances, to the theater, to the opera. And what surprises and saddens me over the years is that these highly accomplished New York City high school graduates, so many of them have never been to or experienced these cultural presentations, even though they've grown up in the city and are some of the smartest, most perceptive kids. So we take very seriously that we are bringing a diverse audience into the theater, and it is by introducing audiences to the cultural richness of the city that leads to change on and off stage as well. BAM, the Public, the Flea, and David Henry Hwang all share a commitment to diversity that we will learn more about tonight. But first, they have a special treat. Before they speak, we have something important to say, Gracia Marson said. Let's welcome the Macaulay alumna, Sarah Zweig, to say a few words about Macaulay and about her studies here and how that led her to a career writing about the arts. Afterwards, Sarah will turn the discussion over to David Hwang, and the conversation will begin. Thank you again for your presence here, and there will be time for questions afterwards. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. I'd like to thank Dean Pearl, as well as tonight's coordinators and guests, for holding this panel on diversity and inclusion in the performing arts. My name is Sarah Zweig, and I graduated from Macaulay at Hunter in 2011. As the dean indicated, the arts were fundamental to my experience at Macaulay. During our orientation, we saw Spring Awakening and discussed it in my Arts in New York City seminar, where I also saw my first off-Broadway show. I also used the Opportunity Fund to travel twice to London. We saw a West End show every weeknight, attended backstage tours, and even used our free time to explore even more theater. My critical passion for theater and the arts has only increased since then. Shortly after graduation, I started a theater criticism blog, Letters from the Mezzanine, where I discuss important themes and issues of representation and storytelling in current shows and old favorites. Macaulay is founded on the idea of empowering the city's diverse student population with a chance to pursue an exceptional education at no cost. This idea is also practiced in the honors curriculum. Macaulay students, many of whom are first-generation college students, explore New York's cultural and social history and the diverse possibilities for our city's futures in the honor seminars. I would never have had the freedom to take the professional risks in pursuit of my passions for the past 5 years had it not been for the opportunities Macaulay gave me. As for tonight, the question of diversity and representation is precisely the discussion going on in the theater world right now. How do we best promote the work of a range of artists of different backgrounds, races, and genders? How do we attract more diversity in our audiences by reflecting their experiences? Tonight's panelists are at the forefront of that discussion, changing the face of the theater world by writing, directing, or presenting radically inclusive and widely popular works. I'm going to hand things over now to David Henry Hwang. Thank you, and please enjoy tonight's panel.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you to Dean Pearl and to all of you for being here today. So I'm going to start by telling a little story about how I got my first production. So I was a senior undergraduate in college, and I wrote a play to be done in my dorm, which it was. And then 14 months later, it opened off-Broadway here in New York at the Public Theater, the institution that Oskar now runs. So how did this happen? Well, a lot of lucky things happened, but one particularly important aspect was that about a year before my show, which was called FOB, or Fresh Off the Boat, which is now a TV show, but it's not the same thing. about a year before, the Public had done a piece by a playwright named Len Jenkins called New Jerusalem, in which a Caucasian actor was cast in an Asian role. And this led to maybe the first yellow face protest on record in New York City, where the Asian actors of that day went and protested in front of the Public Theater. Subsequently, Joe Papp, the founder of the Public Theater, who was still running at that time, who's arguably the most important American theatrical producer of the last half of the 20th century, Joe being who he was because he had a commitment to issues like social justice and wanting to make a theater that looked like New York, Joe called the protesters into his office and hired one of them onto his staff with a brief to find plays for Asian actors. And it was just about that time that my play came across his desk. So I'm basically a beneficiary of affirmative action, because that's what affirmative action does. It locates a social need and then creates a program to try to address it. And against that backdrop, today in this discussion, we're looking at two studies that have recently come out. One, Dean Pearl referred to the Department of Cultural Affairs study where they looked at diversity within the cultural institutions in terms of staffing. And in general, New York City is about 33% white, and the cultural staff of the institutions is about 61% white. And theater does particularly badly, unfortunately. At 70% white, it is the 14th out of the 16 categories that they identified. And so that's one study that we're looking at. The other was taken by the Asian American Performers Action Coalition, or AAPAC, And basically what they did was took Broadway and the 16 largest not-for-profit theaters and broke it down in terms of who was on stage and the ethnicity of the actors. And if you average out the 9 years of studies that they've done, basically it's 78% white, 13% African American, 3% Latino, 4% Asian, and 1% other. So I think we would have to say that a industry where the participants are 80% Caucasian, that would not be considered a good diversity figure in any field. I have to say that, point out, public theater comes in number one in terms of the most diverse theater with 38% white, and that the 2014-15 season, the most recent for which they broke down statistics, showed a substantial improvement in terms of going down from 78% average white to a 70% average white. So there is potentially improvement going on. But against that backdrop, the DCLA study and the APAC study, I guess what I want to ask all you guys first is, how do you react to that, and how do you see your institutions using this information? What programs do you are you thinking about, or have you implemented to try to deal with this? So, Nigel, you want to go first?
Sure. Great. So, I'll tell a little story. The institution I run, the Flea Theater down in Lower Manhattan, was founded by Jim Simpson as a project. It was a 5-year project to see how he could push the boundaries of off-off-Broadway. And when the institution decided to have a life beyond that projectness, there was an intense self-looking, inward-lookingness, to say, how are the people on our stages actually representing the people of New York? And so to begin, we have a resident company of volunteer actors called the Bats. And so each year we have open calls. But not only do we have an open call for any performer who wants to come in, we have targeted calls to say you are welcome to this organization. So that means there's an Asian and Pacific Islander call. There's a call for actors who have disabilities. There's a call for African Americans and people of the African diaspora. But not only do we have that call, we then sit down, me and the producing director then sit down with the candidates, and it's based on the abilities of the people in front of us, but we sit down literally with the numbers of what does New York City look like? And so is that, 15% Asian identified? And so we want our company to look like that, plus some. Because what we want to have happen is for any director to be able to come into our company to see a plethora of New York City to then cast that on our stage. And from a leadership perspective, that means early on in the conversations with any creative members that come to do their work at the Flea, for instance, we're doing a show that is set in Budapest right now. It is about Hungarian Jews. And so one might assume that everyone on stage looks like what predominant Hungarian Jews look like, which is presents as Caucasian. But in our production, the leading roles are by an Indian American, an Asian American, a Black American, several white Americans, because we have a commitment to that. Now, that's on the stage. It's what happens behind the stage. Luckily for us, we have been able to cultivate a staff. We have a small staff, but it's 60% female. We have an Iranian American, we have a Malaysian American, we have me. But that's because as we're going through, as we're going through our hiring practices, we are having an ongoing conversation about that the voices in the room are dictating the choices that happen on stage. And if we as a staff are representing multiple points of view, then it is more likely that we're going to be honest with each other about the programming that happens. What we have a great amount of work to do as an institution is in the playwrights that we hire. And so that has become a specific interest of mine. I have a group of resident directors, and they're tasked with bringing me the writers and materials that I don't know, and they all know what the directive is. The directive is, don't bring me a bunch of plays written by people who look like everyone around here. That's what we do.
So BAM is a slightly different organization, I suppose, in the sense that we're a multi-genre presenter.
So. Can I just point out that you actually have to turn the thing on, which I
didn't do. So if you're
not using it, you can hear me, but you can hear me anyway. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So again, we're a multi-genre presenter, and you asked about the response of the DCA survey. You know, we present work from all over the world, right? So there are the two biggest tasks that I think are incumbent on an organization like BAM. One is to make sure that the choices that we're making about what we present are representative of, you know, the world we find ourselves in, but also that the people making those choices, and that is very, very hard, right? To find high-level curators in this area, that is a real challenge. And that is something that has been identified, I think, in the art museum world. It's been identified as part of the survey. So that's one part of the challenge. I look at it as a bottom-to-top, top-to-bottom challenge, right? We also have a board of directors, right? How do we address diversity on boards? That's a very, very big issue right now. How do we address issues of diversity on staff? And again, I think the survey pointed out, you know, to our mutual embarrassment, that we do not want the diversity in our staff to be in the custodial and the security part of the staff. We want the diversity in our staff to be representative of the professional staff and the curatorial staff, and the, you know, in our case, this would be administrative, production, and curatorial. And then the other really big question for me is about accessibility, and this is not just about diversity. This is about how are your programs accessible and affordable across the board. Like, so we have 750,000 people coming to BAM every year. That's a lot of people in a borough that is extraordinarily diverse, and you know, what are the things that we already have in place, and what are the things that we have to do more of? Well, the things that we have in place are a third of our tickets are, you know, $35 and below, right? If you're anybody in the room an IDNYC member, right? Fantastic, right? So we have,
yay!
So Oskar and his wife can come to BAM for $14 to the movies, right? So thank you. We never have time for them. IDNYC is actually an extraordinary gateway. In terms of affordability, you don't get anything at a membership event until you buy a ticket, but you can buy half-price day-old, you know, tickets for main stage and for cinema. So affordability is a really big deal for me. Accessibility is a really big deal for me. In terms of diversity of audience, if you look across the board at BAM, it really depends. There are some programs at BAM where we have almost exclusively audiences of color, as it were. And there are some audiences that, quite frankly, aren't like that. And for me, a little bit of a challenge is education is one of the biggest barriers to cultural participation. And, you know, that's a big issue for us. How do we make our materials clearer? How do we market to people so that they feel like the institution is for them? So, you know, I take a very broad view of this issue because I think that helps. I think it's about education, it's about affordability, it's about accessibility of the buildings, something that I even talked briefly to Oskar about. You know, how do you make your buildings seem like they're accessible to people? So again, it is about curatorial choice, it is about who's on stage, but it's also about, you know, if we're trying to present the best work there is in the world, how do we make that feel like that's something that you can experience? And 750,000 people just simply isn't enough. You know, millions more people should be able to see what we do. So that's how I sort of think about it broadly, and that's how we really reacted to that survey, which is it's a cross-constituency challenge for an organization like that.
The public's commitment to diversity is in the DNA of the organization. It's what the organization was founded with over 60 years ago. And so the fact that, you know, this last year we had 62% actors of color on stage is not an accidental thing. It's something that is a successful expression of what the theater stands for. Let me try and just talk. I feel in great danger of blathering, which I think will bore you guys. So let me try and actually just pluck out, because we work on this all the time, so there's masses of verbiage I could say, but when I pluck things that I think are successful. The board has made a commitment over the last few years, and I was very frustrated with it at first because my partner, Patrick William, insisted that we form a committee, and there's a corporate committee, so we got people outside, and we had meetings, and I thought, oh my God, can't. And then his brilliance started to show, and one of the things was that that committee of the board hit upon a metric that was actually achievable, because the only metric we'd had was the demographic metric of New York, which is 33% white, 67% non-white. That wasn't going to happen on my board of directors. My board of directors has to raise money. That's the big thing I need them for. We weren't going to match that metric. So in a way, that was an excuse for inaction for a long time. And then what the board came up with was a different metric, which was the demographics of four-year college graduates in New York. What I like about that metric is that's actually the real pool of who potential board members are. That's actually who could actually be on the board. And it's still only 51% white, 49% non-white. And now we have it, we voted on it, it's in the, you know, it is now a motion of the board that by 2022, that will be the composition of our board. And we know every year how many people we have to move off and what color they are and who we have to move on. And we're 18 months into that, and it has been extraordinarily effective. And now, will we actually achieve that by 2022? In the middle of our capital campaign? Oh, that's going to get interesting. But what's beautiful is it's actually a metric. It's an achievable metric. And because it's an achievable metric, although it's still a big stretch, it's one the board has internalized. And they've made their own task. Another thing, when we look at the staff, and this is going to be so obvious to this audience, but we were stupid and slow. One of the things that we had to face is that in reality, how you got on staff at the Public Theater, there was only one route that was consistently better than any other route, and that was to be an intern at the Public Theater. That, you know, not everybody got a job. But lots of people did, and when we actually analyzed it, about a third of the people who were staffing our theater were coming in through internships. Well, listen, internships that don't pay anything, you have automatically created your demographic before you even started. So I'm happy to say that next year we have gotten the budget and it's been approved that all of our internships will be at minimum wage. That's there for the express purpose of saying that we have to open up the routes of employment to people who don't come from privileged backgrounds. Third thing, I'm just talking about the successes. If I start talking about the failures, it would be too depressing, right? And then you might not like me as much. But here's something that, you know, being the, you know, Paleolithic sports fan that I am, I advocated for some period of time that we adopt the Rooney Rule. And the theater has now formally adopted the Rooney Rule that whenever we have an opening, we are not allowed to fill it unless we've had a face-to-face interview with a candidate of color for that position. And that's it. No restrictions on who you have to hire, but you just have to have a face-to-face interview with a candidate of color. Good God. Again, in about 24 months, absolutely noticeable change in who's staffing the theater. And again, it's getting at unconscious bias. It's getting at all the ways that we tend to just hire the people who are most common. You know, and actually I've got this job over here, and I know this guy. You know, he's gonna be great. Why do I? And as soon as you just put the rule down, it just changes the parameters of the world. So those are some of the, and the last thing I wanna say, which is was really depressing for me, is we did our first in-depth across the organization metrics about our audience that were pretty detailed. We had general things, but really tried to do. And to my horror, our metrics were nowhere near as good in the audience as they were on stage. We're better than most of the other theaters in terms of the diversity of the audience, but not as much better as we should be. And that even extended to Free Shakespeare in the Park, because Free is huge for me, I totally believe. But still, it wasn't as good. There was only one program where the metrics were absolutely representing the city of New York, and that was our mobile unit. And it became clear that, and that has led to, over the next five-year plan, we're doubling and tripling down on the mobile unit, because it's just clear that the only way that we can be guaranteed to reach a diverse audience is to go to where they are. And that just has to become a central part of what we do. So I hope that was a minimum of hot air.
You know, I often think when I look at the statistics of the people on stage that, yes, it seems like it's a sort of a community issue, it's sort of a social justice issue, but it also strikes me as being a bad business model. That essentially, you know, if you take the proposition that people like to see themselves on stage or like to see themselves in films and televisions, then, and that this country is going to be a majority people of color by 2040-ish, then you know, it does not seem like a smart business move that that we continue to favor only one group, and a group that's demographically shrinking. It becomes a little like the Republican Party. But what do you think? How do you weigh those? I mean, do you think of this as sort of a service to community issue? Do you see it as a business model issue? I mean, it's probably a little bit of both. But how does, you know?
I just want to weigh on that a little bit. I see it as an artistic issue, right? We're not here. Ultimately, I mean, the thing that makes us different from all the other institutions in the world is that we are here presenting art. And so where is the art coming from? Where will the art come from? Who will the people be that produce the art? And so for me, it's not, I mean, yes, of course it's about community and of course it's about business model. But if you don't start with what it is that you do and what you might be missing out on if you're not represent, then that's, it sort of starts with that for me. I mean, it's not, you know, the people who actually decide what goes on the stage, we have to really, really care about that. And for me, that comes first.
Yeah, I have to echo that. You know, one of the first things I looked at when I arrived at the Flea, I looked at, okay, so where are we? We're down on Thomas Street between Church and Broadway. Thank you. but literally two blocks away, we have a vibrant Chinese community. And yet, I looked back through our production history, and not once have we produced a play or a performance that spoke directly to that community. And so that has now become part of the mission of our theater, which is not only to reach all of New York City, but to be reaching our immediate neighbors. And so that means that everyone on staff is tasked with showing up at the community meetings, showing up at the art that is happening, the performing arts that are happening around us, and finding those artists that we're going to nurture who are speaking to that community.
Well, certainly, I bitterly regret our decision to not cast Hamilton with all white people, because we would have been more successful. But of course, absolutely true. The other point I want to make, and I'm going to risk hot air for a second because this is a little, but I believe it, is that for the theater, specifically as an art form, it is always at its best and most vibrant at times of democratic expansion, when the society and the theater is suddenly reaching far more people. That was true in in Athens, on the side of the Acropolis. It was true in Elizabethan England. It was true in the 1930s with the Federal Theatre Project and the Group Theatre. It's true in the 1960s. And, you know, if we take the example of Shakespeare, this is maybe, I think, the best example, which is it's absolutely clear, if you trace the history of Elizabethan theatre, that it was the audience that created Shakespeare. Shakespeare was a great poet. There's no question. Nobody taught him how to do that. But what happened for the first time because of the Tudor Compromise is you had secular places of entertainment in which all classes and educational levels of the community were gathered together and demanding to be entertained at the same time. Illiterate groundlings and Oxford grads, aristocracy and bankers, all gathered together, 2,000 of them at a time, sometimes up to three, and all sang, "Tell us all one story that we're all going to love." And that need to speak to all of those people at once is what made Shakespeare the playwright he became. It forced him to expand the range of who he was speaking to simultaneously talk high and talk low. And in doing so, not just, you know, in different parts of the play speak to different parts of the audience, but the whole play had to speak to everybody, which meant he had to reflect back to the audience what made them one people. What did they have in common with each other? Because we all know, right? That's the real magic of being in the theater, is it's not watching on stage. It's actually feeling like you are one with everyone. You're all holding your breath at the same time. You're all laughing at the theater. That's why you go to the theater. And with that massively increased democracy in the audience, it forced the artists to respond to it, and it forced Shakespeare to become the greatest playwright in the history of the language. So it's good for the theater. Basically, it's what makes the art better to make the art, to demand that the art speak to everybody. It's, and you know, one of the things that what follows is hot air of less interest.
This is great following Oskar. The other thing I would say is, I don't, and I maybe alluded to this in the first set of things I said, but it's something I want to come back to, which is, I don't think it's good to think narrowly about an audience for a show. Like, we're going to put on a Hispanic show and we're going to look for a Hispanic audience. I find that deeply patronizing to the audience and to the performers, right? And if you're a global presenter, if you're really presenting work from a, you know, this is also, like, in the world we're living in, right, do we feel like people have more or less of the things that are familiar to them, that are relatable to them? I'm not sure I like the argument about relatability, but I also believe in the argument about you going to see something that is completely alien to you. So what do we come back to if we make that argument? We make again the argument of, okay, this may be completely alien to your culture. You may see nothing in it that you relate to, but it blows you away, right? That's what art is also supposed to do. So how do you get people to that? And again, that comes back to accessibility. That's not about putting on something that you think will speak to the person that lives next door. That's about saying art is important, and sometimes it's going to make you uncomfortable about who you are and what you are. And that is as important as the universal relatable language. I'm tired of relatability, right? I'm really tired of relatability, because I think it confines people where people should not be confined. I think it's patronizing. So I think that is important when you consider, this is not to say that we shouldn't be representative, but it is also to say that we should be adventurous. And when you think about an institution like BAM, what's in BAM's DNA is, look at all the art that we put on that nobody wanted to see, right, way back when, right? Harvey was out there in Brooklyn shouting up and down about this work that nobody wanted to see. Nobody said to him, well, you should just put on stuff that people want to see, that people can relate to. And he just said, no, I'm going to put on this stuff because it's great. And what was incumbent upon him was to try and make it something that people would go to. And that's about the experience of going to the theater, that's about the price of going to the theater, that's about who you go to the theater with, where you hear about it. And those are marketing challenges. So that's just something I want to put out there when we think narrowly about relatability, because that is, I'm really tired of that.
In terms of audiences, then, I mean, the sort of the DCA study would imply that, to some extent, if you diversify staff, then it helps to diversify content, which then helps to diversify audiences. But Oskar, you're talking about, for instance, in your theater, that the content is very diverse and the audience is not as diverse. And Katy, you're also talking about sort of making people, you're expressing it as a marketing challenge, of making people sort of want to see something that's going to be challenging. So how do we expand audiences, and do we have different notions, even on this panel, about the relationship between programming and expansion of audiences?
Well, there's two fundamental things we need to do, and Katy's referred to it. Price is a huge issue, an enormous issue. I find people make an enormous effort to try to talk around price as if that's just, oh, that's just the money, that's not the most important. Price is unbelievably important. And, you know, one of the things that we sit in one of the buildings that was the foundation of the New York Public Library, and what I remind my board and staff all the time is there was a time when the idea of a free public lending library was completely radical. The idea that anybody could be able to walk in and for nothing take out a book and bring it back. And now it's not a radical idea at all. And it's the same thing we should do for performance. And I've said this a lot, and so what I'm hoping to do is in the 17-18 season start to realize it, is bring the free model downtown so that we actually are, because that's one of the problems with Shakespeare in the Park right now, is that everybody knows Shakespeare in the Park is free, but everybody assumes that it's sort of, oh, well, that's Shakespeare in the Park. That's exceptional. And so it doesn't serve as any kind of provocation. If I can make a downtown free, then I think immediately that's a provocation for everybody who's not making, I can't stand that. Everybody who's not making their places free. And, you know, the other thing, the only other
the point I want to make is I want to be sure to talk about this program is we started 4 years ago the Public Works Program, which every fall does these big community pageants, which is based on an extraordinary history in this country between 1880 and 1930 of public pageants, which I didn't know anything about until we started researching it. And there was a national pageant association that had representatives in every one of the states of the Union. John Reed did a pageant at Madison Square Garden about the Patterson strike, using the Patterson strikers on stage. And, I mean, just extraordinary stuff happened. And so what we try to do, without going into great detail in the Public Works Program, is actually blur the line between professional and amateur performers and say that artistic talent and artistic creativity is not a binary. You either have it or you don't have it. You're either making it or you're watching it. It's a continuum. And we can actually put on stage Tony Award winning actors and actresses next to people who got released from jail 3 months ago and are on stage for the first time in their lives. And they're all part of the same continuum. And again, by showing that it's all part of one continuum, saying the act of making art is yours, not just the act of consuming it, but it's actually part. And it's been explosively successful, that program. It's now, we have offshoots in Dallas and Seattle and Detroit, and we've limited it just so we can keep control of the experiment with those three places. That other cities are clamoring to do it, we're expanding it. So that, for me, has been an incredibly exciting frontier to start to actually break this idea of professional as an entirely separate category rather than simply as really, really trained specialists in the same thing that we can all do. And I've loved that. And that audience, by the way, that is the one non-mobile audience that is as diverse as this city. Mm-hmm.
That's really all right. That's so interesting. I feel so much at a disadvantage. I've only been doing this for, next week will be a year. But artistic leadership, like leading an institution, is so new to me. There have been so many things that I've learned and so many ideas I've had that like have already been tested. But one of the things that I keep coming back to with my institution is how are we communicating that we are a civic organization, that we are here for all. And I mean, we're lucky. You know, our biggest theater is 74 seats, and we have a resident company of 102 actors, and so a lot of them are going out and asking their cohorts to come and join them in this experiment and experience and figure that out. And we have something similar at our late night shows, which are downtown, which are artist led, and so you've got this very diverse group of folks making material that's important for them, inviting the collaborators they want to be working in, that's our most diverse audience as well. And so there's a lesson in there that I want to take back with me today to think about, you know, because one of our initiatives for the new building is we have anchor partners, and our anchor partners, we're the anchor, and we're partners to theaters that are itinerant and need a home to develop audience around. And so part of my philosophy around that, of course, have been like different ways of making. So bring those different ways of making so that these different audiences are seeing, oh, there's space for the kind of work, and this is where we have some disagreement. You know, like I know that certain people, their way of access into the building is a certain kind of making or a certain kind of selfness being presented on stage. But then what's my job is then to say, oh, you tasted that, come over and taste this other thing while you're in the building.
Well, and to speak to that, I think, you know, again, when you're presenting across disciplines, one of my goals is, and actually I heard our chairman speak about this the other day, and I thought it was a wonderful metaphor. You know, what you're trying to give people is a handle to grab onto with your institution, a way in which they can, to go back on my previous statement, relate. And, you know, at BAM that can be a lot of different things. You know, you can come and do stargazing on the roof of the Fisher, right? When I figured out that we did stargazing on the roof of the Fisher, I was like, well, that's it. What else is there? But you can do stargazing, you can participate in an education program, you can come to a free program. We have 100,000 people coming to BAM every year for free programs, and I'd love to do more. And I also think that this notion of space and where things happen is actually really important. So, you know, when you were saying the word anchor over again, we think about that a lot at BAM because we are a cultural anchor of Brooklyn, right? That's a very important thing to BAM. We really have always, for the last 50 years, really wanted to provide people, home is in our mission. We wanted to provide people with a sense of this is where you can come and feel at home around the arts, whatever that is for you. But now I think there's a sense in which we're looking at more decentralized ways of engaging with communities, because it's, you know, recently we went out and we talked to communities in Brooklyn again about, well, you know, what do you think about what BAM's doing now, you know, in 2016? And a lot of them said, I love BAM, but I don't know enough about what you do. Can you tell me more? And again, I hate to go back to the marketing analogy, but it is, think about the performing arts. We market very aggressively, to go back to the board question, which is we need money. We market to the people we're going to make the most money out of, right? The people who are going to march from being a single ticket buyer to being a subscriber to being a patron, from ignorance to ownership, right? That is the development marketing spectrum. So when you only market to the people you think you're eventually going to make money out of, that's when you sort of stop talking to everybody else. And you can talk to people in lots of different ways. It doesn't have to be through a piece of paper or through a social media channel, although those are great ways to talk to people. You can actually talk to people by being in their communities and making work with them. And I'm an enormous believer that, you know, making art, inviting people to participate in actually making art, is incredibly important. People have a completely different experience and relationship to art when they get to make it, sing it, play it, write it, you know, and giving people ownership over that. And a lot of our education and community work is based around that idea. Yesterday I was with a high school group who had choreographed an entire performance and put on a show with full production values in a theater. And that, you know, that's just, it makes me cry. It's just, and the previous week I was in a school classroom just after the RSC residency watching a bunch of eighth graders recite the St. Crispin's Day speech, and that got me choked up. I mean, it's just incredible stuff. But you have to be willing to talk to people, to not limit what the conversation would be at any particular time. And it's really, you meet people where they are, and then you have the conversation. And in that sense, we have no disagreement.
Right.
But, you know, it's a lot of different things. It's a lot of different handles. And you have to be persistent. That's another thing. I think over time, you have to be very, very persistent and not give up. Longevity really counts in these efforts.
I want to underscore this idea of decentralization.
Yeah.
Because I think, because we're talking to remote stakeholders and leaders, because one of the things that was really interesting to me when the board hired me, I make work in public spaces, I go to communities and make work with the communities, participatory work about the urgent questions that they're wrestling with. You know, so for instance, in Times Square, working with a group of people of multicultural about the George Zimmerman verdict right there in the space. And the board said to me, we want you to keep doing that work, which is insane to me. A place that's building a new building that needs to be programmed and needs to, you know, that they were thinking about those things. But our tentacles out, you know, think about like the spokes of a bicycle wheel. We've got these locations in the center, but our job is to like create things down there, go out, go down to the other area, do something there, bring them back to our space, have a connection, go out again, and just keep moving through.
I was in Madison, Wisconsin last week. And I was talking to a group of students and faculty and stuff, and one person asked, oh, well, I'm interested in doing a South Asian play, but we don't have any South Asian actors here in Madison. And then somebody else said, well, you know, have you checked out the blah, 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 you know, the sort of South Asian theater in Madison? And they haven't. And so, you know, so generally when people say, I feel like I've spent a whole career, like, writing plays that people thought couldn't be cast, and then did get cast. And, you know, usually the people who got cast won awards for them. And it, you know, it reminds me also of the sort of relatively well-known culture war incident from the 80s about, you know, around, or early 90s, around Miss Saigon. And when Jonathan Pryce got cast as the Eurasian Pimp, and they said, well, we did a worldwide search to find somebody, and then years later we learned out there actually wasn't a search. So I tend to feel like when people say we can't find these people, that they're not looking or they're lying. So as this relates to not only what's on stage, but in terms of administration, you were talking about the Rooney Rule a moment ago. Do you think to what extent is this a pipeline issue, or to what extent is this simply not putting the opportunities on the table and looking outside the usual suspects?
It's both. And and you have to work on it from both ends. You have to work on it both in terms of making sure that you are figuring out how you look better and how you create more opportunities to apply. But you also, you know, part of it, when you were talking about relatability being a negative, I'm sorry, here's the thing that occurred to me, or that I remember, it was Alfred Kazin, the great American literary critic, grew up in the Bronx, in the Coops, poor immigrant son of immigrant Jewish parents. And he described in his memoir, he described what it was like for him going to see Clifford Odets at the Belasco Theater, Awake and Sing, that the group theater put on, and he could only afford the seats in the second balcony at the Glasgow, which are really terrible seats, I gotta tell you. But, you know, but they were like a dime in the 30s. And he said that he had never experienced anything like it, because he said, the way he described it was, seeing my aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters on that stage, holding it down by right, as if they were Hamlet or Lear, change my view of myself completely. And that's what I'm so aware of with, you know, when we put the public works folks on the Delacorte, and it's not like the people who are on stage there, but people who are watching them on stage at Delacorte, and are able to say, wait a minute, I own this. And it literally, in our case, because that stage belongs to the city of New York. We rent it from the city of New York. It's their stage. And that's so much what you have to do is make it possible for people to imagine themselves able to do that, rather than seeing it as something that only folks who go to Yale, or only people who go to MFA programs, or only the rich, or only, you know, it's how do you make, and that's a lot about trying to model the possibilities, and then keep throwing open the doors of training and opportunity for people to come through them, but you gotta show people that there's a place for them. Nobody's
going to
want to walk through.
And I think, you know, to echo what Oskar's saying, you know, when that survey came out, there was a lot of talk about people running the institutions. You know, it's not enough, sadly, that I'm a Welsh woman. This is, doesn't count for much in the world of diversity. It's that conversation was very important, because I heard people talk about the educational part. And we started, you know, I started by talking about education a little bit, and how that it gets shut down very, very quickly. And the path to, you know, to being curators in the art museum world is staggeringly narrow. I'm just talking about when you say, have people not looked? I don't know. I can't speak for that industry, but the fact is that we've ended up in a situation where there are, you know, only a few people of color running art museums in this country, which just seems kind of staggering. And that's not dissimilar in the performing arts.
Yeah, and let me give you a very specific thing. One of the things that I've proposed to the board that I think is they're going to accept as part of our 10-year plan is that we have a line item in our budget for succession planning. Right. And I haven't figured out exactly how we're going to spend this, but the idea is that if we assume that I got roughly 10 years left, that part of my job, and we know it's my job because there's a budgetary line item, not just because we say it's my job, but part of my job is to prepare a set, not one, but a set of people who could replace me, that so that by the time I step down, I have taken responsibility for creating a pool of candidates, basically all of them should be women and people of color, who the board can select from, and actually even the best of all possible, by the time I step down, the board knows all of them, because I've actually worked them through, so that it's actually part of the job of the institution to change the path of succession.
And that, I think, we've been, on the whole, very bad at.
Yeah.
I don't think there are any major institutions that have really tackled that. I shouldn't say any, there probably are some, but I think that
most of us want to think we're irreplaceable. Certainly Joe Papp had the idea that, you know, when he left, it should all go to hell.
But there are models out there. I mean, there are models. I've benefited, and I think you benefited as well. You know, the Theater Communications Group had a fellowship for me to be mentored by you, so that I could be prepared to take a position like this. You know, and so then, like you said, you have to put the money to where your mission is. You know, like that's our Flea fellowship positions for our new theater are only for women and people of color. And those are specifically in the technical theater field and in the producing field. Because we looked at the institution, again, who are the people that we've been training to come up there? The other place that I think that we have fellow stakeholders amongst us. And so not only are we creating that fellowship for ourselves, but we're working specifically with culturally specific organizations who are becoming anchor partners so that we are you know, sharing with each other who are the young leaders that we should be looking
at. And I think, you know, the other area that's very important for an institution like BAM is, you know, we stand and fall in our ability to put up and take down shows very quickly. Like we're putting up an enormous number of shows every year in the fall, like 53 original productions, you know, between September and December. And so the crew, right, the people, the electricians, the carpenters, the wig makers, the costume, you know, these are highly skilled jobs, and they're good jobs. In this city, they are union jobs,
mm-hmm.
right? So talking, you know, one of my tasks long-term, or one of my ideas long-term is, you know, is how to involve the union in this conversation, because historically those unions have sort of, and they have very proudly, and I want to say this with all due deference and respect to them, they have proudly handed down their trades, right? We had a carpenter at BAM that retired this year after 4 years, who had been a carpenter in the opera house for 4 years, can you imagine that? And he got his job from his dad. And you know, and I think those, because those are good jobs, their families now have more choices, right? So their kids don't necessarily want those jobs. And there is a moment, there is an opportunity here that actually people in the city are talking about in terms of the behind the scenes work, because that's very important to me, that people also feel like there's a, you know, you can do a lot of work in the community, and at a certain point the community says, well, how can I work at your place? How can I have a job? How can I actually come and earn money and do this thing that seems so wonderful? And so a pipeline into an actual profession of being, you know, an electrician or a carpenter is also really important. So I think, you know, we're looking at stagecraft as an apprenticeship model at BAM, as well as the, you know, the curatorial stuff, and the admin stuff is a little easier, but the production stuff is really fascinating. So much fun.
I mean, the succession question is partially, it's a function to some extent of the age of the organizations as well. I mean, this wouldn't apply to BAM, but so many of our not-for-profit theaters were founded someplace around the 60s, early 70s, and so the founder, but we're sort of now cycling through, we're starting to cycle through the end of the baby boomer period in terms of leadership.
Well, that does apply to BAM, because you have Harvey, Karen, Joe. Right.
Okay.
You've got three people who run the institution for 50 years.
So I guess my question is, do you feel like, for people coming up now, does it make sense to try to change the institutions that exist, or to start their own institutions the way that most of the ones who were, that are major institutions now, were founded by people, many of whom are still alive? Or, you know, what's your advice to young people coming up?
I made a very specific decision about that about 25 years ago, which is I spent the 70s and 80s essentially trying to form a couple of countercultural institutions, founded and built them as the Redmond Theater Company and the Eureka Theater in San Francisco, with the goal, which many people shared at that time, that there was enough nonprofit theater activity that you could have the big motherships, and then you could also have big, successful, maybe not so big, countercultural institutions. Wait a minute, that didn't work. And so what I decided was, as you know, I said at that time, it's time to go work at theaters with the fountains in front of them. That it actually, metaphorically, you have a very big fountain. The idea that there were certain cultural institutions that the culture as a whole had decided were legitimate and were going to exist, and that the real interesting battle was to take control of them and try to make sure that the work and the artists and the mission and the program of those institutions reflected what I thought of as the relatively radical ideas that I had. That was my life choice, which has dictated everything about my professional life since then. The other thing that I see happening, which I find very exciting, is an awful lot of young people forming companies that have nothing to do with bricks and mortar, than finding companies that really are embracing the transient, ephemeral nature of performing arts and coming together and going apart and staying light and fleet and like you do at the Flea, and as you do, forming relationships with big bricks and mortar institutions that can help them do their thing without them having to take on that responsibility. And that, for artists who are looking for ways to really refine their expression, that seems to me like a much smarter way to go than trying to found another institution.
And I think actually the world I came from was actually the world of classical music, and in that world, that, you know, the task of writing music for orchestras became so hard, so difficult, because orchestras weren't programming it, they were becoming more conservative in their programming, that actually people started to form collectives, composer, performer collectives, right? There are lots of them in New York, lots of them around the country, they're fantastic. And they're exactly this. They're collaborative, nimble, virtuosic, you know, organizations that then come and play our venue, you know. And I think it's a different cultural moment to the 60s and 70s. There were a lot of founder organizations that sprung up in my field, and I'm sure in other fields too. And I think it is a different moment. I think Oskar's actually right, you know. You can form something, and we're not as obsessed with the idea of permanence in that situation as well, which means you can form a company, you can break it apart, you can come together again. I just really
want to make a case for not accepting the idea that the big cultural institutions belong to the other guys. This is America that belongs to all of us, and
right.
Storming the Citadel is a beautiful impulse.
Storm away.
Great. So let's open it up to questions from you guys. First question's always hardest. Oh, good. Let's start with you. Yeah.
Hi. I have a question about representation and diversity on stage in terms of actors. I didn't grow up in this country, so my ideas about race are learned, given the fact that I didn't know that I was black until I came to America. You. So, in terms of like a moral meter of what's right, I feel like I understand that it is acceptable to see, for example, an all-black production of Death of a Salesman, or an all-Asian production of Renata Alba, but it's not okay to have an all-white production of Fences or Raising the Sun. So, my question is, and this I'm really trying to think of, like, I understand that it's wrong, and I'm trying to understand what the root of it is. Is it because, historically, there's been a lack of opportunities for actors of diversity, actors for minorities, and so now when those stories are being told, they should be honored, they should be sacred in terms of the people who they're written about get to perform them? Or perhaps theater has a dark history in terms of misrepresentation, in terms of black face or brown face or yellow face, and so we have a moral obligation not to correct that by not doing that or not, and that it only works in one direction. So I'm just curious what you think is just the root of what is acceptable and what isn't. My own theory, so.
I kind of like to look at it as an employment question. And that if you look at the statistics like that we were talking about earlier today, and you basically say 80% of the roles in New York are cast with white actors, then the task becomes to decrease that 80% figure. And for me, that leads to a certain amount of aesthetic inconsistency. It's why I like it when there isn't, you know, all the Asian Bernard Alba, but I don't like it, or I wouldn't like an all white Fences. Because the latter decreases the 80% and the other one increases it. So that's how I look at it.
It's practical.
I would also have to say that there's no excuse from history. We never get to pretend we're not in the historical moment we're in, particularly when we're making theater. We never get to pretend that we're not in the place we are. It's totally about this moment in this place. Mm-hmm. At this moment in this place, the history of European Caucasian people appropriating the lives and stories of people of color around the world is so enormous that it is still going to be centuries for us to undo that process. That's the moment we are genuinely in. We have to take seriously that moment. And we have to take seriously that if this is supposed to be of the people, by the people, for the people, if this is genuinely democracy, that the huge goal of that is to give everybody the chance to view themselves as the heroes of their own lives, to view themselves as the subjects of history, not the objects of history. And what we we do in the theater is a slightly less practical version that results in exactly what David is saying. But what we have to do in a theater is participate in that struggle and not somehow claim that there's an abstract art thing where everybody should. It's not true. We're in the history.
There isn't a level playing field. We have to.
Did you care ahead of?
Yes. So my question is more about mental health. And I feel like when we're talking about diversity in the arts, especially theater or cinema, that the conversation about relatability I felt like was really important, because we can talk about it being a pipeline issue, but not everybody wants to be the sacrificial lamb or be the first, because being the first is really hard, and we have tales of that. So how do we kind of create a nurturing environment for those people who do want to do the trailblazing if the roles are not yet there, but they still want to be a part of theater or movies? So I was just curious if any of your institutions also work on that aspect of creating a space for people to.
That's a fantastic question. And I mean, I'd be lying if I said I totally had the answer to that question. I think we wrestle with that question all the time. I actually go back to thinking about some of the work that we do with kids in Brooklyn, mostly in Brooklyn, not exclusively in Brooklyn. And I went recently to a program we do called Arts and Justice. And the important thing about this program is really about, I don't think those kids would want to be the first people to stand up and express, what they think and feel about big social justice issues alone. Right, so the real purpose of that program is to create a context in which they feel that they can, create a community of people in which they can write their own material and put on a show. And I think it goes back a little bit to the questions of, how do you empower people by giving them creative license? And how do you give them the resources to do that? And how do you create safe places to do that, it was interesting to go to the first workshop when they're all looking at each other and like, well, I don't know whether I can trust you, there you. And by the end, they're absolutely. And so I think it is about creating community. It's hard to do it alone. And I'm not sure you have to do it alone. But I mean, that's an imperfect answer, but your story brought to mind my experience of watching students go through that experience of forging a community in which they felt safe to talk about issues that are pretty substantial. The last year was about police brutality, and this year was about women's empowerment. And they went on every issue. That was really important to them. And to see them do it theatrically was, for me, that's different to just talking about it at school in a talk, right? To actually put on a show and talk about it.
I'll just respond with some ways that have come for me. One is through leadership, and specifically through leadership training. We availed ourselves of a consultant who came in to show our entire staff and talk with our staff about the language we were using, about the way we work together, and about how we talked about story and narrative in our space. And we have a particular a hurdle as an institution, because not only are we, multicultural, multi-ethnic, but we also have a lot of volunteer labor. And so there are real opportunities to actually take advantage of people. And so one of the two things come up. One, as a leader, I have a job to show and act out best practices. So I'm in a meeting, and one staff member says about a brown-bodied staff member, male, the boy can write.
Yeah.
Yes. And so it's my job, as I did in that moment, and I said, you may not know, but when you say boy in reference to this person's body, it has a historical relationship that we need to be aware of here. Secondly, I realized very early that we weren't actually doing the kind of communication that would make us stronger as an organization. And so after every performance, now there's even another moment of it, but after every performance, we have a totally anonymous Google sheet where people talk about things that went wrong in the process that could have been better for them. Times when they felt taken advantage of, times when they weren't heard totally. And now we've actually begun pre-mortems, which we'll do for our next season, where actually we sit and we read all that. So I programmed the plays. Everyone has the plays now on when I get back June 6th. And sorry, looking at a staff member. On June 6th, we're going to sit down as a staff, and we're going to say, how could we, we got to opening night and we fucked it up. We didn't take care of each other. What are the potential obstacles in front of us?
Pre-mortems are great.
I'm afraid I can only take two more questions, so I'm going to go to the back, you and you on the end there.
Thank you. This is more of a historical question. I was wondering how theater became such, like, seen as such a luxurious type of enjoyment, and also how New York is a very specific demographic in the fact that it is the most diverse city in the entire planet. So how would you, and are you as a collective view, going to expand past New York City? Because there's plenty states and plenty cities outside of here that need that type of injection of diversification, and they need to know that it does work as a business model, and it does work as just as cultural exchange and understanding, being empathetic to other people. So it's kind of a two-part question.
Two very different parts. The start of the question is actually pretty simple and pretty depressing, which is the theater, despite there's a brief period of time in the 1930s with the formation of the Federal Theater Project, and then there was another, I'm sad to say, it turned out to be a brief period of time in the 60s and 70s with the foundation of the National Endowment for the Arts and some support of particularly the Ford Foundation, where it appeared that the theater was going to break loose from the marketplace and there was going to be a national movement of theater as a, not simply nonprofit, but as a civic right, as something that actually belonged to people the way libraries belong to people. That movement was killed in 1939 by the House on American Activities Committee that shut down the Federal Theater Project because of communist infiltration. And it was interesting, the Roosevelt administration actually traded away the Federal Theater Project. They actually, in committee, agreed to let Congress shut the Federal Theater Project in exchange for not shutting the entire WPA. I'm sympathetic with Roosevelt, but I wish he had done that. Then from the 60s to the 70s, it really, that moment, we can mark the ending of it on the second Tuesday of November 1980 when Ronald Reagan was elected, because the start of the right-wing counter-revolution essentially meant that the idea of the theater as a serious art form that belonged to everybody died a national death, and therefore is kept alive in individual theaters, in individual communities, by individual artists. But essentially at that moment, the decision was made by the country that the theater was going to respond to the market. And so the theater has become a luxury item because the whole market has become about luxury items. We're not any different from any other luxury item.
And I think, we shouldn't walk out of this room without feeling properly frightened about what the possible trajectories are this world isn't, people ask me, are cultural organizations getting too big? Are there too many of them? I'm like, I cannot believe we're having this conversation. It's like, I feel like, culture is sort of on the ice a lot of the time. And people up here, we're all sort of, my predecessor used to say, it's not a job, it's a crusade, right? And I think we all kind of feel that, right? This is important, and this could go away. And so to answer your question, to go back a little bit to what I said about global work, we are lucky to be in this city, right? And as bad as we have done on some of these issues, we've done a lot better than some other places. And you're right, that there's a lot of places that need the tolerance and compassion and comprehension that the art can really bring, right? And that's why we're all here. There's a program at BAM that I love called Dance Motion USA. This is a program with the State Department, which is a program about cultural diplomacy. And just had a dance company come back from Laos and the Philippines and Indonesia, and they're working primarily with disabled populations, making dance. And the program we talk that much about because it happens so far away, but every year we send out a bunch of companies to a bunch of different countries in the world, and that's another fabulous program. But And it, don't be complacent would be my advice about all of this. Those people that are aspiring to be in the arts, do not be complacent. And as much as we are self-critical, don't imagine that anything that we're doing isn't really for the better. You know, because you've got a lot of well-intentioned people here, and you need to keep the faith.
I'm going to take this last question.
This is a very quick question, so maybe there will be time for one more question. But where is the rebuilding of the Flea going to be?
We're still in Lower Manhattan. We're on 20 Thomas Street between Church and Broadway. Every major subway line is within 2 blocks.
It's really good to ask a short question, because I actually meant to ask the person behind. But, you know, this is hard to read.
If you could snap your fingers and change one thing, wake up tomorrow and have one thing be changed about the theater community, what would that one thing be?
Can I cheat and do two? Literally, I just like to tip the scales the opposite way and make the seats free and pay artists a living wage.
Yeah.
Okay, we all agree.
I just want to thank our fabulous guests once again for spending the evening with us.